let's focus on computing some integrals where we have trig functions. Our first example is going to motivate the discussion for the rest of this video. Let's take the integral of sine cubed x dx. It looks pretty straightforward and simple, but it turns out to be rather difficult. Let's see. My first naive approach might be to say, aha, I know how to integrate things raised to the third power. That's just going to be sine of x to the fourth times 1/4 and plus c, and I'm done. I just raise the power and I multiply by the reciprocal. This is incorrect, right? And why is it incorrect? It's because it ignores chain rule. That if I were to go backwards and take the derivative of this, I would see that the 4 would cancel with the 1/4, so it would be sine of x, but I would have to worry about chain rule and multiply by the derivative of sine of x, which is cosine x, which isn't in here. So maybe I'll put a line through that, that we know that you can't just use power rule when you have a function on the inside. Wouldn't it be nice if we had a u substitution, if there was maybe some cosine lurking in here so that we were able to do this? Because as it stands, we aren't able to use any of the rules that we've done so far. So what can we do to this to be able to get that cosine for a u substitution? We're going to make use of some trig identities. So I'm going to use the fact trig identity. I know that sine squared x plus cosine squared x is equal to 1, and that just comes from Pythagorean theorem. And that means that I can rearrange this and rewrite this original integral as the integral of sine squared times sine and then I can write, because this is just sine cubed, that's two sines multiplied by each other times another sine multiplied, and I'm gonna rewrite this Pythagorean identity as sine squared x equals 1 minus cosine squared x by subtracting cosine from each side and doing a substitution. So that means that I'm left with 1 minus cosine squared x times sine of x dx. Now, why is this helpful? This looks a lot more complicated than what we had to start with. But it turns out, now we have a u sub that we wanted. There are a couple of different approaches to finish off this problem, and I'll show you each of them. One is to start and just do the u sub right here. So I'm going to set u in this case is going to be equal to my cosine function, because the derivative of cosine is sine, and I can make use of that. So I'm going to let u equal cosine of x, and then du is equal to negative sine of x dx. And I can convert these pieces in this integral. So that means that my integral is equal to 1 minus u squared, and the sine x dx, I need a negative to get my du from this negative sine. This is something that's really easy to integrate. I can use polynomial rule. The integral of this is equal to u. Well, I have a negative on the outside, so I want to keep track of that. A negative on the outside, the integral of 1 is u, and the integral of negative u squared is negative 1/3 u cubed, and I can distribute that minus sign and see that I get 1/3 u cubed minus u plus c. I probably should have had a plus c in that last step as well. So notice that we used a trig identity and pulled out something that would be our u to be able to integrate this. We could have done the u substitution in two steps, and this is something that I'll highlight quickly, that I could distribute this and I get the integral of sine of x minus cosine squared x sine of x dx. And I would still have to use a u substitution. I could just break this into two separate integrals. The integral of sine of x is negative cosine of x, and the integral here, I would have to use the same u substitution that I did here. Oh, and this solution will end up with the same solution that we had here, which is 1/3. What was my u in this case? Cosine of x cubed minus cosine of x. So, that's one way to solve this particular problem. Let's look at another example, and then we'll generalize what we've found. So in this next example, we don't have sines and cosines. We have tangent cubes and secants to the fourth. This looks sort of overwhelmingly complicated at first glance, but I'm going to remind us of a couple of facts, and that'll make this a little bit easier. So the first fact that I want to remind us of is the derivative of tangent is secant squared. So if I were to set u equal to tangent of x, then I would know that my du would have to be equal to secant squared x. So I see some tangents and some secants. That's one thing that I might keep in mind. Or if I were to set the other order and let u equal secant squared x, the derivative of secant is secant tangent, secant x times tangent x. So these are derivative facts that you should know from your previous calculus class, or you might want to look up at a table to refresh yourself. So this is one thing that I'm keeping in mind, that I know I'm going to want to pull out something to be my u. Like if I let u be equal to tangent, then the du, I see that I have a secant to the fourth here, maybe I can make use of that. Similarly, maybe if I set u equal to secant, maybe I have some secant tangents to work with. The other fact that I'm going to make use of is just something based on what we saw before, that sine squared x plus cosine squared x equals 1. This is a trig identity I want you to memorize. And if I were to take this identity and divide everything by cosine squared x, why would I do that? It gives me a new trig identity, and this is one that I don't have memorized, but it's easy to memorize if you just think of dividing our original function by this. Sine squared divided by cosine squared is tangent squared. Cosine divided by cosine is 1. And 1 over cosine squared, that's just secant squared. So here's another trig identity. As well as some derivative facts that we're going to use to be able to solve this problem. So, you could memorize a bunch of rules. Instead, we're going to use some ingenuity to try to figure out what we want to do. I'm thinking to myself, if I pull out a secant squared to act as my du, I would need to convert everything else into tangents. Let's see if we can do that. So let's approach this problem by pulling out a secant squared factor. So that leaves us with a secant squared x. I'm breaking up my secant to the fourth into two secant squareds. And I'm thinking to myself that one of those I want to leave as my u. And this other one I want to convert into tangents. And thankfully, I have this identity that can do exactly that. So this leaves me with tangent cubed x times tangent squared x plus 1 times secant squared x dx. Notice I haven't done any integration, there's no calculus. All I've done is trig substitution. And in my final step, I say, aha, now I can apply this clever u substitution. If I let u, maybe I should do it in this order, if u is equal to tangent of x, then du is equal to secant squared x, and I have dx, and I have this secant squared dx sitting right there. So that means that this becomes u is tangent of x, so this becomes u to the third times u squared plus 1 times secant squared x dx becomes my du. Maybe I shouldn't have parentheses there. And this, again, is something that we know how to integrate. So I'm going to multiply through. Notice I cannot integrate each piece, but I'm not allowed to say, aha, this is the integral of 1 fourth u to the fourth times 1 third u cubed plus u. By taking the integral of this chunk and the integral of this chunk, that does not work. Why does that not work? Well, you can verify by taking the derivative of this and seeing that it doesn't line up. Instead, I'm going to have to distribute this so that they're actually polynomials, and I get u to the fifth plus u cubed du And when I integrate this, I get 6 u to the 6 plus 1/3 4th u to the 4th plus c. Sorry, I'm being a little messy. And then I can plug in my original u, which is tangent of x, and I get 1/6 times tangent of x to the 6th plus 1/4 tangent of x to the 4th plus c. So let's summarize some of the things that we just talked about. How do we go about solving these trig integrals? So if I have some integral and it has a bunch of messy trig stuff in it, what do? We want to isolate a single du factor and then convert the rest of the factors into u's using trig identities. So that's one method. Or sometimes you just need to simplify what's going on. So you might want to break up tangent into sine over cosine, for example. That might be something that allows you to convert into trig identities in a way that you didn't see before. And also there are a number of trig identities that might make something complicated be a little more simple. So here is a helpful list of some u and du values. This is actually just a table of derivatives of our trig functions. So for example, in the first problem, I let u equal cosine, and so my du was negative sine. And the second problem, I let u equal tangent, and so my du was secant squared x. But usually you're looking over to see what du's do you have to work with, and then try to work backwards to see if I can convert the rest of the stuff into what the u looks like. Here are some trig identities that you might use. So you have memorized sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1. And like we saw, if you divide everything by cosine, you end up with this identity. And if you divide this whole top thing by sine squared, you end up with this identity. So these bottom two are things I don't memorize. I just memorize the first one and then do helpful division. But these over here are other possible identities that are helpful. Let's say I have a cosine squared by itself and 1 minus sine squared just isn't cutting it. Then here are some ways that we can convert those as well. So let's finish off with a tricky example. So this last one is the integral of cosine squared x sine squared x dx. And this is one that you might think that you would want to do a u substitution. So let's start off. Maybe I'll use my black pen to differentiate, sorry. Let's set our u equal to sine of x. Then our du would be cosine of x dx. So things are looking pretty good. So we could isolate out one single cosine, and we would end up with, to get our du by itself, we end up with cosine x times sine squared x times cosine x dx. So this could be our u, or our du. And the problem is that not everything here is in terms of sines, which is our u. We have this one remaining cosine, and we don't have an identity to turn cosines into sines. We only have an identity to turn two cosine squareds into sines. And it turns out that because this cosine is raised to an even power, this type of u substitution isn't going to work, and we're going to have to be a little more clever. Even I could go as far as to convert this u in, and I'd see that I would get cosine x times u squared du. What do I do with this cosine x? There's nothing I can do with it. So let's go back to our table and see if there's something helpful. And it turns out, well, I have a piece that looks something like this. So let's see if we can make use of this particular trig identity. This isn't integration. This is just a known fact about trig identities. So going back to our original problem, we can see that this integral could be rewritten as the integral of cosine x sine x all quantity squared dx. Why am I allowed to do this algebraic step? This is because cosine squared is just cosine times cosine, sine squared is just sine times sine, and unlike if the terms were separated by a plus sign when you would get middle terms, this is just cosine times sine times sine, when they're all factors, then it works out nicely. So now I can apply this substitution. Sine 2x is equal to 2 times this. I'm going to divide both sides by 2, and I can simplify this into 1 half of the sine of 2x all squared, which in turn becomes, I'm going to distribute this squared. Again, each of these terms is multiplied by each other, so 1 half squared is 1 fourth. I get sine squared, and I'm not distributing the 2 into this because this is not a separate term. This is a function of sine, and thus we end up with sine squared of 2x. There are a lot of arithmetic mistakes that I see on problems like these, so I want to highlight some of the arithmetic as I go. Huh. So maybe this is better, but it still doesn't look like I have a u that I can work with, right? Because now I only have sine, and if I change this into 1 minus cosine, I would only have cosines. So we're going to have to, so this was one trig substitution, right, using this trig identity, and then we're going to have to do it again. We're going to change the, we're going to use the fact that sine squared x is equal to this mess. So let's, I'll write this up over here. So I'm going to pull the constant out front. This is just 1 fourth of the integral of, and again, the identity says that sine squared of x is equal to blah, but it's not sine squared of x in this case. It's sine squared of 2x, so I'm going to replace x by 2x, and that makes this a 4x. So this is the integral of 1 half of 1 plus the cosine of 4x. Dx. And I can pull the 1 half out, so I get 1 eighth times the integral of 1 plus the cosine of 4x dx. Why is this good news? Because cosine is something that we do know how to integrate. Cosine squared is tricky, but cosine on itself, integral of cosine is just sine. We are going to have to do a u substitution because it's not x in here, it's 4x, but that's a pretty easy step. So I'm going to let u be equal to 4x, because then du is just equal to 4 dx. So I'm going to need to convert this by adding a 1 fourth. So I have 1 eighth times 1 fourth times the integral of 1 plus cosine of 4x. I multiply it by 1 fourth, and I get a 4 dx. This can convert into my du. I get 1, 8 times 4 is 32, and the integral of 1 plus cosine of u du. I can integrate 1/32. I'm integrating with respect to u, so my 1 becomes a u, and the integral of cosine becomes sine of u plus c, because of the indefinite integral. And in my final step, I plug in my u again, and I get 1/32 of u was equal to 4x, plus this all becomes sine of 4x plus c. And we're all done.